Hello, and welcome to A Conversation with Kevin Godley. I'm your host, Eric Miller. This is part of the Pods and Sods Network. And I want to thank you, first off, as always, for clicking the download button or the subscribe button or whatever combination of buttons you've clicked in order to find this episode. It's always appreciated. Kevin Godley has had a long, long career, and he's an interesting guy, to say the least. Smart, quick, funny. And we get into a lot of his work. Obviously, you know, him discovering music or art as a kid, what his focus really was before, you know, 10cc. And then we talk about 10cc, how they went from, you know, doing the Neil Sedaka records to being sort of a democratic band on their own rights with, you know, hits and you know, a really a creatively abundant period. Talk about him first meeting McCartney during that time, you know, why he left and sort of what he missed and didn't miss from leaving. And then obviously a lot about Godley and Cream, you know, the Consequences record, which was a big milestone in his creative life, what it was like working with Sarah Vaughan. And then obviously the Cry video, and then, you know, tons of other music videos, Duran Duran, George Harrison. I asked him about Two Tribes, sort of in the context of Donald Trump and Kim Jong-un, which is interesting. And yeah, it's a great conversation. And obviously we talk about his new projects, which he has a Pledge Music campaign for something called Musicle Memory, which is super duper cool. If you're a fan of his, you should check that out, because it's, you know, essentially you can co-write with him, which is amazing, right? Like, he has a mechanism that you can pledge and you can send in some music, and he'll select it and he'll sort of flesh it out. Well, he'll talk about it, and obviously what's next for him. So without any further ado, hopefully you'll enjoy listening to this as much as I enjoyed recording this conversation with Kevin Godley. Gives me great pleasure to welcome Mr. Kevin Godley. Welcome, Kevin.
Thank you very much. A pleasure to be here.
Thank you. Thanks for taking the time to chat with me. You have a long and super interesting career, and we could probably talk for days just on, you know, music video questions or whatever, any era of your career. But I want to touch on most of them, or some of them, to some degree.
Okay.
And obviously, the thing you're working on now is a Pledge Music campaign, which is super interesting, and I want to get into that. But kind of going back to the beginning, can you remember at a very early age, like, how did you first start tinkering with music? I've heard you talk about sort of borrowing your father's guitar. Do you remember how you first came to music?
I guess I was lucky in that my father had a number of shops in the Manchester area, and one of the shops he had was a music shop. And another one that he had sold radios, TVs, tape recorders, cameras. So one way or another, even though I showed no inclination to go into the family business at all the tools of my forthcoming trades existed within my father's domain.
Wow.
I don't know. I guess I got interested in making music because that's kind of what kids did then. Same as kids go skateboarding and play games online. We kind of made music back then in those early days, pretty right. Scrappily. But ever since Elvis arrived, everybody wanted to be Elvis, and then everybody wanted to be in the Beatles. So I don't think you went any further than that in terms of it being art and capital letters. But kind of everyone wanted to be in a band, you know, one way or another. So that was kind of my intro to it. And it sort of, I guess, gradually over a period of years, it seeped into my soul that was something I should be doing maybe a little more seriously.
Right.
I was going to say was from an early age, I was the only thing I could do well was draw or paint or anything to do with the arts. was an instinctive thing with me, and I guess making music was an extension of that.
Right. So did you, as a kid, did you tinker with cameras as well? Because you said it was in his domain. Did you like you picked up a guitar, did you pick up a camera at a young age?
No, because they weren't movie cameras, they were stills cameras, and they
Right.
were the old kind of cameras with lots of dials and numbers and things you wind, and they were very complicated, with lighters and those kind of things.
Right.
And so they looked amazing as objects, but I was always too scared of dropping them. So I didn't get into that right away.
So when you ultimately go to art school, like what are your sort of focuses? You mentioned illustration.
Well, yeah, focus basically when I went to art school was to stay there as long as possible, which I did. I was at art college in one or other courses for about 8 years because I don't know, there's something about art college that you're not just there to learn how to draw or paint or design. You learn what you're about, I guess. And I suppose that's true of any university or college experience because you find yourself living away from home. So you learn a lot about yourself. And I had no idea what I wanted to be or do. It was simply about aiming vaguely in the right direction, because I didn't want to be a businessman. And as art was the only thing I could do, I managed to persuade my parents to send me to art college, and I stayed there for as long as physically possible. But towards the end of my tenure at art college, I was still in bands, and the band that I was in was kind of, I was, maybe playing gigs 3 nights a week as well as studying design. And, it was a difficult balancing act. But I remember distinctly the first thing I did on leaving college and graduating was, along with Lol Cream, we both drove to London to our first proper recording session. So in other words, I spent 8 years at art college, got a decent qualification, and went straight into the music business.
Right, which I'm sure your parents were thrilled about, right? After 8 years of
Well, I think they kind of lost it by then. I think by then it was obvious that whoever and whatever I was not quite what they hoped I would be. They pretty much left me to my own devices and were encouraging, I guess. I suppose they were like any, my dad was probably like any dad. Look, he'll get it out of his system. Let him join a group. He'll make a record. And then eventually he'll come and beg me to join the family business. Which actually didn't happen. And when I did have a hit record, it was my son, the pop star, that kind of syndrome.
That's great. I want to ask about, the way 10cc came together was a bit organic. You guys did the Neil Sedaka records, and from what I've heard, it felt a bit, or it sounds a bit like sort of stumbling into it. Like, okay, here we are. Now there's the four of us, and
Yeah.
it's something of a, did you? Were you concerned, or was there any sense that, you might just be a house band, or did you, how did it evolve into growing something beyond that?
Into a band.
Right.
Well, yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And I think the common denominator between all four of us was Strawberry Studios coming into existence. Had that not have been the case, I don't think everything would have panned out quite the way it did. It was the fact that suddenly there was a reasonably professional recording studio as a base in Stockport, which was kind of 20 miles outside Manchester, which is not really where you expect a recording studio to be.
Right.
But as you probably know, it was set up by Eric Stewart, who wanted to be a producer engineer, and his partner Peter Tattersall, and it was only a small affair. But he knew Graham. Graham had joined his band, the Mind Benders, take over from a guy who left. So there was one connection there, and then we eventually met Eric. I think Manchester was a relatively small music scene at the time. So one way or another, everybody kind of knew everybody else. And Lol Cream and I were brought in one day to help Eric test the new equipment. It was like a sandpit. It was a musical sandpit. We were just kind of playing around in the way that we did. We didn't really know what we were doing. And it was a very gradual process. People began to come to the studio. Local acts began to come to the studio. Some very diverse acts, anything from a football team to a ventriloquist, would show up at the studio. And for whatever reason, the four of us became sort of joint house band stroke producers.
Right.
Probably because there was no one else that would do it.
You're like you guys were like the Booker T and the MGs of Strawberry Studios.
Yeah, Booker T and the KGs, yeah, I guess, if I was in there. But yeah, but I guess we were. But I suppose the odd thing, and probably a good thing, is that, you know, it wasn't America, so the influences that were exerted on us weren't American influences, they were local influences.
Right.
And some of them were really sort of shitty showbiz things, sort of working men's clubs, as well as football teams, and TV producers' wives and oddments. It was almost like, you know, anything could walk in the studio, and we had to be capable enough to turn our hand to producing and playing this stuff. So towards the end of this period, our grasp of production and musicianship was pretty eclectic. There was no direction as
right.
such
right.
at that point. And we've been doing this for a while, having fun. It was, you know, it was fun. It was, you know. And then we were asked to record an album by a very odd duo called Ramesses. Ramesses was a central heating salesman from Sheffield who thought he was a reincarnation of Ramesses II. And his wife, Selkirk, was his wife. And they were very odd, very interesting. And we got to make an album with them. And I think that was probably the turning point where we gelled and coalesced as a unit, all thinking along a very specific line in order to create a tangible record for these people that had a sound, that had a particular individuality about it. And it was kind of at the end of that we weren't just messing around. We felt we'd actually achieved something as a unit.
Right.
And then I don't think it was long after that we were asked to produce and be a house band for two albums by Neil Sedaka.
Right.
No idea why he came to us. Perhaps we were cheaper than LA musicians. I have no idea. But again, we did two albums again. And again, this added another string to our bow, because the Ramesses album was all about production and experimentation and investigation and exploration. But this was very simple. It was about sitting in the studio and playing together.
Right.
Which, and again, that experience gelled. So at the end of those two projects, we had the component parts of something. We knew that we, sorry, that's my computer making gurgly noises. We realized that, okay, we could produce and we could play. And at some point shortly after that, the penny dropped. It was like, well, why don't we form a band? Oh, yeah. Why don't we form a band? Because we pretty much are a band.
Right, right.
So, you know, I think it may have been Neil Sedaka who suggested it. I honestly can't recall. But that's the genesis of it. It's four disparate characters trying stuff in the studio and realizing over a period of time that actually we're all thinking along similar lines. Maybe we can take this to the next logical stage.
It's just a silly phase I'm going through. And just because I call you up, don't get me wrong, don't think you got it made. I'm not in love, no, no. Give it back.
know, one of the beautiful things about that configuration of those four people, yourself included, is, you know, it seems very democratic, right? There's no front man per se, right? Which is interesting, because then you kind of avoid those tensions of, you know, struggling for attention, you know, jealousness of a star, that kind of stuff, right? And it kind of, does it afford you the luxury of just focusing on the music?
Well, yeah, we never, well, at least at that stage, we weren't a group in the normal sense of the word. So there was no singer, guitar player, drum. We were more like four scientists in a lab.
That's great.
And the only thing, as you quite rightly say, that mattered was the end product, is the music any good? So, and we would all turn our hands to anything if we could. There was no real ego problems at that stage at all. It was no, you do this, I do that. There was none of that.
Right. Yeah, that's great. I wonder about, and it's cool when you look at the various sort of configurations of songwriters on those 10cc records. And, you know, this guy with that guy kind of produces one recipe, and that guy with this guy produces another recipe. Can you talk maybe a bit about this friction or a balance? How are those things essential for creativity, right?
Well, okay, so you've got four guys, all with one focus, I guess, which is to create something great.
Right.
And you have, at least initially, you have two separate temperaments, I imagine, two different working styles, because Lola and myself came from an art school background, which teaches you to be open to anything.
Right.
And both Eric and Graham came from a successful songwriting and rock and roll background, which teaches you a craft and how to approach a craft in a certain way. So you had all the ingredients there that 10cc became. And what usually happened was, I mean, Lowell and I have been writing since we were college, with no success, but just for the hell of it. We had a way of working. I think Eric and Graham were kind of thrown together because they hadn't written together before. But because we were young and because we were incredibly focused at that time, it all worked. And again, as you pointed out, there was no sort of ego tripping going on. If any of us had a song that we thought was worthy, we'd bring it in and play it to the others, and we'd all comment, and we'd say, well, that's great, but what if you, it's a bit ordinary here, what if you pulled it off to one side and did this? And they'd either say, you're out of your mind, or that's much better. But in the end, it was really, and again, it was down to the studio, it was down to the fact that we could say, okay, well, let's just try it, you know, the studio's empty tonight, let's go in and try it. And it came from that willingness to explore. I think we all had very high standards in terms of what we all felt we were trying to achieve without knowing exactly how to define it.
Right.
But when we hit something that was good, we all kind of agreed that it was good. There was never any, that's great, that's shit. You know, we all usually agreed on that.
Right.
And it's usually unanimous.
And it's, you must look back on that with, you know, such reverence, because there's not, it sounds like such a fruitful period, but there's also not like business getting in the way. It's just artists making art.
Well, I think a lot of that was because we were away from the hub of music. London was pretty much it. I mean, Liverpool became something when the Beatles arrived and the whole spin-off from that, but mainly the recording industry and the record labels were all down in London.
Right.
So we were in a kind of creative vacuum, but in a good way. We were kind of left alone just to crack on. And in the early days, it's interesting, one thing that I realized in the early days, before 10cc existed, we didn't really have a particular identity as such. We, like many bands do, or many artists when they're starting off, they try and copy or subconsciously ape artists that they admire.
Right.
So, you know, nothing's good unless it sounds like the Beatles, you know. So I suppose we were vulnerable to that attitude. But it was only, I think, once we started recording the first NCC album that began to go away, and we began to forge something that was very unique,
right,
without even noticing, in a
right.
way.
Right. Is around this period that I believe you first met Paul McCartney. I think he was recording at Strawberry when you guys were doing your sheet music record.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that first? Meeting Paul McCartney. I mean,
Well, you know, it's like, you know, you're seeing album covers for the first 10 minutes. So, but what a lovely guy. And very natural, very unaffected, not remotely starstruck about himself at all. He was there in the evenings recording an album with his brother, Mike McGeer. And we kind of cross over about 6 or 7 o'clock. Our session was finished. And he'd come in the evening and, you know, he'd listen to some of the stuff we were doing. And then the next morning we listened to some of the stuff he'd done. And it was lovely, very relaxed. There was no star bullshit.
Right.
And Mike was lovely as well. And we've known him since then.
Right.
But no, you know, it was. I suppose it was a great slap on the back for Strawberry Studios that someone of Paul's caliber came there to record. You know.
Yeah. No kidding.
That's a great badge of merit.
Yes. That certainly brings in subsequent clients when you say Paul McCartney is recording here, right?
A lot better than you say if Bert McCartney was recording there. Yes, definitely.
Hey, let's not slam Bert McCartney. He's awesome.
He's fantastic. Not many people know of him. He's, you know, but
right.
What a catalogue.
One of the things I want to ask about, you know, obviously, ultimately, you know, you leave 10cc and that story has been told. But the question I'm curious about is, you know, now it's you and Lowell and you guys are doing your own thing. Is there a part of you that during that time, you know, you had a fruitful period with Lowell, but is there a part of you that kind of missed that four-way, like the other elements that the other guys brought? Did you, you know, was it somewhat bittersweet? Did you miss those other things to balance what you guys were doing, or...
I think probably like many bands, we were young, you know, so we were full of ourselves when we went our separate ways. So, and we have stuff we had to do. A man's got to do what a man's got to do,
right?
And all that crap. I do and I don't in a way. I it was fun,
right.
But maybe I've become more of a control freak or more possessive or want to make a different kind of music. And I'm not sure if those four individuals, probably, I'm thinking of them like machine parts, you know, we've probably got rusty and our threads have changed. We probably wouldn't fit together as well as we did then.
Hmm.
And like any band, I suppose, there are certain tensions that were there when we did split that I'm not 100% sure that they would work anymore. I miss the camaraderie of that particular period of time where it was, you know, kind of four guys against the world. That was kind of nice.
Yeah.
And, you know, we were all so focused and, you know, we wanted to make great music and all that stuff. But the world's changed. We've changed.
Right.
So part of me misses the dream of it, the fantasy of it, and the magic of that moment. But I'm also, I'm aware that it probably wouldn't happen again.
Right.
Not in that context, anyway.
Yeah, that's kind of the linear nature of life in general, but of being a creative person specifically, right? You sort of, you ultimately evolve, you know.
Exactly.
The first solo work you guys, the first Godley and Cream work you guys did was was consequences. How do you look back on that creative from a creative perspective?
It was okay. I think we got above ourselves a little bit.
Okay.
I think what had happened, mind you, that's in hindsight. At the time, it wasn't like that at all. At the time, before 10cc came together, we'd invented this musical device called the Gizmotron, which was a mechanical device that bowed the strings of the guitar. And it had sat around in the form of a prototype for a while. We used it a little bit in 10cc, not a lot, but it had been on ice.
Right.
And towards the end of 10cc's tenure, we thought we should actually see what this thing could do. So we went into Strawberry for 3 weeks and we started messing around with it and playing with it and exploring it. And we, Lowell and I, had such a ball doing that. It was essentially instrumental music, so the pressure was off. We didn't have to write songs anymore. And I think what happened shortly after that was we were due to start another album. And Eric and Graham played us a song that they'd written. I think it was called The Things We Do for Love.
Right.
Turned out to be a big hit for them, but they played that to us in the studio, and it was like, oh God, I don't like this at all. I want to make something much more interesting than this. And I said so, I said, this is shit. I probably didn't mean to say that. I probably meant to say, well, actually, it's not quite my cup of tea. But
Right.
it came out as, this is shit. I don't want to do this anymore. And it was it. And Lowell felt the same, essentially. We felt we'd grown somewhat by trying this other form of music. And after the How Dare You album, we didn't feel that it was all becoming a little predictable. The
Right.
lifestyle was predictable, the music was a little bit predictable, the jeopardy had gone, the danger had gone, the sense of being an explorer had gone. It was all about, that album was all about, we need one of those, two of these. We need a long one and a short one and a funny one and a sad one, It was a little bit, getting a little bit formulaic. And so off we went, and suddenly something that was going to become an experimental single album turned into a triple album because, like myself, wanting to stay at art school as long as I possibly could, we wanted to stay in the studio as long as we possibly could
Right.
and defer releasing anything because we were having such fun, essentially. And it was incredibly self-indulgent of us at the time. And we got lost in it, I suppose. It became our heaven's gate.
Right.
And we didn't care and we didn't notice that the landscape was changing
Right.
as it should. And at some point, I don't know, we were probably working at the Manor Studios in Oxfordshire. And suddenly this thing called punk came out of nowhere, which was the polar opposite of what we were doing.
Right.
We were kind of dragging along in the wake of 100 other concept albums that, had done quite well, and we were probably one of the last to decide to make one. But we didn't watch our backs,
Right.
essentially. We were too full of ourselves and too full of what we thought was great music, and we got lost. We disappeared up our own arses, essentially. It's interesting listening back to some of that. I think there's some really interesting music on there. But as a project, as a commercial entity, it was a total failure.
Right.
And that taught us a very, very hard lesson.
It's just kind of as a side to that, you don't get to work with Sarah Vaughan every day. What was that like?
That was amazing. She showed up wearing a powder blue trouser suit and hat and sort of glowing in the sort of rather dingy, dark brown English Oxfordshire room with a fire in one corner. It was sort of New York neon meets Sherlock Holmes vibe. And she was lovely. She was delightful. We sort of sat around the microphone and I had to kind of sing for her. Teaching Sarah Vaughan how to sing. This is absurd. But she was amazing. I mean, she got it in two takes.
Wow.
You know, and it's probably one of my favorite moments of the album. It's a lovely song, I think. And so I'm really happy with that. It's probably the best song in an album that wasn't reliant on songs.
Thank you.
One of the big successes of Godley and Cream obviously was the cry, the song, the video, the complete work. And, how do you look back at that now? That seems like it's kind of a real kind of culmination of a journey, like a materialization of something of a life's work to that point. Is that how it was? And how do you see it in hindsight?
Well, yeah, in hindsight, it's a bit like looking back and I'm not in love by Tennessee. It's like, wow, a high watermark. But at the time, we were just, okay, so the story of Cry is, it took 15 years to write. We had the beginning. You don't know how to ease my pain, you don't know. We had that, and we could never take it any further for whatever reason. And 15 years later, we met Trevor Horn. And we were in the studio trying to do something else together, just for the hell of it, that wasn't working. And he said, "What else have you got?" And we said, "We've got You Don't Know How to Ease My Pain." And he said, "Let's do something with that." So off we went, following his lead. And it came together really well, really nicely. So then we had to do a video for it because we were well into doing videos by then. And our first idea was to ask a couple of popular ice skaters called Torville and Dean to do an ice skating routine to it that we would film. And unfortunately, their schedule was too full, so we had to think of something else. And what we thought of was what turned out to be the Cry video. So, it's the usual series of accidents and mistakes and luck and timings. And so we just sent the song out to loads of people and I got them to learn it. And in the studio we came with them and filmed each one of them, took it into an edit suite. And during the editing process that magic began to happen. We started off just mixing from one place to another, but then at some point we tried what's called a soft wipe, which means you can start in the middle of the face and open it out, or start at the top and go from the top to the bottom. And it was in that process, during that process, we realized that we were creating people that didn't exist. On the way from face A to face B, there was Mr. A and a half. And that was magic. But again, at the time, we used to smoke a lot of weed in those days. So we were yeah, this is great. This is great. Next, so we had no particular expectations for it. I think we'd already had a couple of hit records as Godley and Cream by then. We'd had two, but they were pretty, maybe a year or two apart. So we were mainly focusing on our video stroke film work, and we recorded it, which was lovely. And then we did the video, which turned out really well, and then we kind of got on with whatever we were getting on with, and it suddenly was a big hit.
Yeah,
And no
huge.
one could have been more surprised than us. Yeah, and amazing.
Don't know how to ease my pain.
you know, in hindsight, it was just like anything else. It's just the planets aligned particularly well on that one.
Yeah. I want to ask about a few videos specifically. And we don't have to go into super detail, but just some memories if you have them. But in general, when you guys would, you know, get the gig to do a video, however you would phrase that, right? Would you generally storyboard the ideas in advance? Did you collaborate with the artist? Were they hands off, or was probably some of each?
They were pretty hands off. I mean, I think at the beginning of the late sort of 70s, beginning of the 80s, the video industry didn't really exist.
Right.
As such, it was really, and people that were making videos weren't. They didn't come from music. They sort of came from documentaries and drama and news and so on and so forth. And so they didn't have a musical background. Because we did, and I think it's one of the reasons we did well, we got lots of great clients, is because they felt that we would understand what they were trying to do musically a little bit more.
Right.
And so we were given pretty much a free hand. To do things. Back then, the director was king.
You know, right.
Mostly what happened was, we have this track, take a listen to it and come up with a film. The budget is so on and so on and so forth. And we'll do whatever you want. There was no such thing as a video commissioner in those early days.
Mm-hmm.
It was all down to an artist, a director rather, interpreting the song. So, off we go, essentially. Here's your money. This is what we want to do.
Right.
And we'd sit and listen to the track, and we'd just bounce ideas off one another until we thought we had something that made sense. And then we'd run it by our producer, and they'd say this costs twice as much. And so we'd have to slim it back, you know.
Right.
I mean,
right.
I remember that two tribes that we did for Frankie Goes to Hollywood was originally, it was more like a football game with 11 people on either side.
Mm-hmm.
Beating the shit out of each other, as opposed to two. So that's a good example of trimming a budget to get a better result.
But I mean, I couldn't imagine it the other way at this point. I mean, that's so iconic.
No, we'd have never got it. We'd still be editing it, I think.
Right. And as we speak, that's a video that, like, that could very easily be today's headlines, you know, which is, makes your skin crawl,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Although in one of the early scenes where Reagan is tugging at, I think it's the other way around, Shinyanko is tugging at Reagan's hair. In a current context, I think, then that may have come off a little bit earlier. if you get my drift.
I think I do. So that is to say...
I must ask you a question.
Please.
By the way, about President Trump. I wonder if he is aware that the word Trump in England means fart.
I think a lot of us...
In the north of England.
Yes.
North of England, it's a word for fart.
Right. Yeah, I don't know that he has the time or intellectual curiosity to learn that, but certainly thoughtful people in this country certainly are fully aware of that and quite embarrassed by it.
Yes, I agree. Yes, well, my heart goes out to you all.
Thank you. Thank you. And my apologies go to you. So that answer...
I accept.
That answer about the storyboarding and things like that is to say, like, all the debauchery, the wonderful debauchery of Girls on Film came out of your head and Lowell's head. Is that?
Yeah, that's a weird one because, I mean, it's not that debauched, but I don't think you'd get away with it today. The track came in just before we both went on holiday, and I think Lol and Ange went to, I don't know, probably LA or the West Indies or somewhere, and Sue and I went to the south of France. We both had different experiences, and while we were in the south of France, we were kind of hanging out with the fashion crowd, I think Law was seen mud wrestling and stuff. So when we actually reconvened, when we got back after holiday, we sort of compared notes. We had these mad things that we'd all seen. And then what we thought, what kind of situation could house all these disparate elements? We thought, well, actually a catwalk show would do the job.
Right.
So essentially it was a matter of shoehorning all these ideas into a catwalk show and having the band at the opposite end of the catwalk play. And obviously, by looking at the video, we all had a tremendous amount of fun. I think it was cost about £12,000 at the time, which was a huge budget for us. And it may have even been a two-day shoot. What I do remember is faces. We shot at Shepperton Studios. I remember faces appearing round the curtain and watching that weren't from... But the people watching weren't our crew. It was people from other shoots going on the same lot who'd heard about what was going on and come to have a quick look.
That's great. Were there any high profile sort of artists around that time that were kind of a near miss? Like you know, it seems like at some point you guys, you know, ought to have worked with, say, Bowie or Queen. Like, were there ones that almost happened and didn't?
Not I recall that. I'm kind of sad that we never worked with Bowie. Yeah. It seems such an obvious pairing. But I think it's probably because he had, as far as I can tell, he probably had some very strong, clever visions of his own. And he probably chose directors to work with who could translate his visions. Well, what drove us were our own ideas. I don't think we ever worked with an artist who had his own idea. It was all about, and I suppose it's kind of selfish in a way, it was how we interpreted the music. That was it. It was very rare that we would get any input from the artist. I think the only time that ever happened was when we did three tracks with the Police, and I think the first one we did, Every Breath You Take, they were thinking along similar lines. They didn't have a specific idea, but they felt that kind of black and white classicism, almost Citizen Kane lighting, very still, very long takes. That kind of thing was going through their minds,
right,
at the same time that it was going through ours. So it was a meeting of minds rather than, you know, this is what we want to do, boys, go ahead and do it. It wasn't that.
Well, following up on that, so on a video like When We Was Fab, that, like, George Harrison had to, was there direction there, or did that idea come from you guys? Because there's a lot of, you know, historical revisiting Beatles iconography, right? Does that come from you, or does that come from him?
Yeah, that came from us.
Wow.
Because we were, well, we were, you know, we'd always been huge Beatle fans, so it was, it all came from us. And that was quite a shoot, because we had some quite distinguished guests on it. It was mad. It was a mad fucking shoot.
How
but
so?
No, it, again, it was. It was. Sorry.
How so? How was it? How was it a mad?
Because we had him doing all sorts of things, like sort of stand against the wall, allowing people to do things to him, sort of be his other hand and create that illusion. I think, looking back, one of the defining factors of our video work has been artist humiliation. we always ask people to do things that were just slightly out of the norm and that challenged them ever so slightly. I mean, and I don't think this was any different. I think we, you know, it's not the kind of thing you'd think was an idea that would work with George Harrison, but it actually was. It did work. With mad things like Elton walking through and Ringo carrying both ends of a piano keyboard and all sorts of mad shit like that going on. And that end thing where he brings his legs up on the wall and, very psychedelic.
Yes. Now,
as far as I recall, it mostly came from Oz, and again, it was a matter of us interpreting what we heard, and what we heard was him talking about that period of time. That's what connected with us.
Right.
So we kind of did our best to interpret it.
Right. That's awesome. Yeah, that's a classic. And It's interesting. I'm curious about, since we're talking about the Beatles, your videos become something of the fifth Beatle in a lot of songs, right? It's hard to separate, your imagery. It's kind of permanently affixed to many of the greatest songs from that era, right? Like, I don't think anybody could hear Rocket, which is a great song, and not picture those images, the robots. So, I mean, how aware are you in hindsight that you played that role for so many that there's a stamp of your visualizations on these classic songs?
I am aware in hindsight that of course, when we were doing it, we weren't remotely aware because, as I said earlier, there was no. We were just making cool little films to
Right.
go with cool pieces of music. I think what you're talking about was initiated when MTV came into being, not before, because suddenly there was a gallery where video artists could hang their work, and it became the defining medium of that age, I think. And no good song was complete without a good video. And as you say, sometimes people came up with things that were so unique and so memorable that they did stick in the mind. And Rocket, luckily, was one of those. At the time, it was just, again, it was a confluence of circumstance. It was, we heard this, we saw that, those two would go together, let's just film it. And we did, and we came up with this thing. And when we finished it, we sort of thought, uh-oh, what the fuck is this? They're going to throw this back in our faces. This doesn't look like what a video is supposed to be. Mind you, nobody really knew what a video was supposed to be in those days. So without us even knowing it, we were kind of breaking new ground. And we won a few MTV awards for it. I think most good art is good because you're not self-conscious about it. You're not aware of how great it is, of its standing within the medium. It just works for whatever reason. And this was one of those. This was a visual version of I'm Not in Love. Again, it was some extraordinarily visual planets aligning, as well as some audio planets aligning.
One of the things that you work in now is, and I watched your YouTube Mysterious Ways video, where you film things for live performances, right? So it's projected behind the stage at probably some weird scale and proportion. Is that that's got to be something of a new medium for you, just given the size and like how has it been
Yeah, where did
working
you
out?
see that on my website? Did you see that on my website?
Yep, it's on your website. It's boy, it's a beautiful
Yeah,
piece.
thank you. Yeah, well, it's a different. It is a different thing because all you're really doing is you're creating a backdrop. You're framing something, really. So you're not really designing the focus of a crowd. You're creating a way of framing what the crowd is really watching, which is a band, essentially. And you two, more than anybody, have done that particularly well for a long, long time, particularly since UTV, which was I was involved with. So, and they know that stuff inside out, and as do their stage designers, Willie Williams and so forth. They know how that works, and it doesn't always work. Sometimes it can be overkill, but sometimes it works supremely well. Have you seen the current show?
No, I have not. Is there, do you have things in there as well?
No, I don't. But Anton Corbijn did a lot of stuff for it, but it's extremely simple and it's huge. So you kind of learn a lesson from that. It's what the imagery is incredibly simple. But it works because of the scale.
Boy, that's an
That
interesting
plus the
new.
sound is very dynamic.
It's an interesting new period because there's, Roger Waters on his current tour, Muse on their tours. There's a lot of artists that are really, really taking full advantage of this new kind of medium. And it's, like music videos back in the day, it can contribute so much to a live performance. Have you seen Roger Waters' tour?
I haven't seen it.
No. There's a
Was
lot
it
of
good?
There's a lot of good Trump stuff in there that you would probably enjoy.
Yes, I tell you, what I did see. I think it was last year or the year before the Peter Gabriel tour again, which is incredibly visual.
Yeah,
that was great too.
That's
but
awesome.
Music, I mean, pop music, rock music, whatever, has always had a visual element to it. Always.
Yeah. Did you through your sort of arc or development as, you know, from a musician to a filmmaker? I would assume at some point an ambition was to do a feature film. Did that just never materialize? Were there near misses on that?
It almost materialized. There was a point. This is back when I was working with Law, probably around about 85, 86.
Okay.
Where we were sent a script to read. It was a Western called Fandango, written by Big Boy Medlin and Michael Ventura. And we sent the script, and we fell in love with it, and we started to recalibrate it for our sort of film sensibilities. And Robbie Robertson agreed to write music for it. And we got very, very close to beginning production. We were going to do it through Film Dallas, who did Kiss of the Spider Woman.
Yeah.
And our lead role of John Wesley Hardin, who was the what the film was about, was going to be Gary Busey. And he came off his Harley riding through Hollywood one night, and he wasn't wearing a helmet. And
wow.
He hurt himself very bad, hurt himself badly. And so the project just unraveled, unfortunately, from that point. So at least the Godley and Cream moment for making a film didn't happen because of that unpleasant twist of fate.
Right.
And then, you know, a few years later, we went our separate ways. I've written a couple of scripts, and I'm writing one at the moment that I'm very excited about, in conjunction with the Irish Film Board, which I'm hoping, against hope, that I will be able to make as a feature.
Excellent.
Next year or the year after, whenever. So that. So it's not gone away, that desire. I suppose the closest that I've got to it is not a feature film as such, but it was a thing I did called Hog Fever,
right,
with a writer called Richard LaPlante. And it's an audio play about the biker lifestyle, which was fun. So it's essentially a movie in sound,
right,
not unlike what we set out to do with Consequences in many ways.
Right. I want to ask about you. You recently, or in recent years, put out a memoir, which is a space cake. Was it enjoyable to recount, to quote your website, those tales of devil worship and group sex?
Well, it was, as I say in the book, as I start off, it's not really like most musicians' books. It's not, you know, it's not full of people having religious experiences, ODing and fucking everything that moves. That's so boring.
Right.
It was more about work. It's more about work than everything else, And it's like a journal of all the things that I've done and how they came to be. And it was fun, really. It was fun to write. It was an interesting exercise because I found the more that I wrote, the better my writing became.
Right.
I became used to the process of writing something in long form, which was something I hadn't really tried before. So that was great fun to do.
Ooh, yeah. I should have told you all I wanted was to have some fun. But you wanted me to be the permanent one. Yes, you did. Now when we're in the movies or the back of the car, you always stop me when I go too far. I should have known you'd always
always keep me waiting for those wedding bells. Those wedding bells. Oh, we could talk all night, but you won't understand. The only words you wanna hear it, do you take this man? It's my clumsy way of saying that we should be stopping those wedding bells. Those wedding bells. I'm like a square peg in a round hole. I don't belong here, baby. Don't need a fanfare or a drum roll to tell you, baby. To have some fun. But you wanted me to be the permanent one. Oh, I do it, but the pleasure isn't worth the pain. We'd ride a track before we got on the train. Can't you hear the sound of heartstrings snapping under the strain? Those wedding bells, those wedding bells, wedding bells.
Your new project, the brand new one, is a Pledge Music effort, and it's super interesting. It's called Musicle Memory, and I mean, maybe you could explain it. I think you're basically asking for submissions of music, and you're going to co-write or create music with whomever. Can you talk about it?
Yes. Over the last couple of years, I've been sort of dipping my toes into music a little bit here and there,
right.
Recording, but not usually seriously, but just seeing if I still enjoy doing it, and I do, and I did. And during that period of time, two different people sent me tracks, backing tracks, for want of a better phrase, and asked if I'd be interested in writing and recording a song over them. And I said I'd try, which I did. I just pulled them into a garage band and just sort of messed around for a while and found it very enjoyable to do. And the results were very encouraging. I thought they were pretty damn good. One of the tracks is already on. There's a new box set. 10cc box set that's just come out,
right.
Called Before, During, After. And there's one of the tracks on that. So after that experience, it was like, well, hey, now I feel confident. If this process works for these two tracks, and I'd love to make a record again, I'd love to spend a little more time making music, perhaps I can extend the idea and ask people to send me music. Without any thought of, you know, how famous they were or how well-known they were, it's about how interesting the music is and how inspired I am by it. So that's essentially what I've done, and Pledge seemed to be the ideal place to put a project like that, because that's what they're about. They're about fan engagement, and that's exactly what this is, to a degree. If I do, in fact, have any fans, but it's about getting people to engage with artists This is interesting. I've already had about 50 odd tracks in.
Wow.
But I'm in the process of collating. I mean, it's only been up for, what day is it today? Thursday? It's been up for a week.
Wow.
So I'm it may end up as a quadruple album the way we're going. But it's fascinating to hear what real people are doing out there. You know, everybody now has, not everybody, but so many more people have access to music technology than they did back in my day.
Of course.
It's easier for people to make music and send stuff out. So, you know, of course, I'm getting some interesting things to listen to.
So how does that work?
So that's exciting to me.
Yeah. How does it work logistically? So they send it in, and, you know, if they've pledged,
yeah,
then...
they send it in. No, that's a different part. That people are pledging. People that are pledging they're going to buy an album or a T-shirt,
right.
One of the talks I give, or one of the that. So how pledge works is,
gotcha.
The project is funded by the pledges,
right?
And there is a target amount of money,
right?
And once you raise that money, you can begin work. But the submissions is the other side of the coin. These are people who are sending me stuff to turn into songs.
Right.
And they're sending me MP3s and WAVs and so on and so forth. And if I choose a song I want to work in, I will go back to them and we'll communicate, and I will ask them to send me the stems. And we will load the stems into a machine, and I will work with the stems, and then we can... I'll add vocals and whatever else, and we'll mix it. And then myself and this person co-own the copyright of that song.
That's so cool.
So wow. It may be Godley and Smith, or Godley and whoever.
Right.
You know, but we jointly own that song. So essentially I'm sharing the copyrights of the stuff we do with each person that I record a track with.
That's awesome. And have you gotten, of the stuff you've gotten, it's delivered on the promise, yeah, of excitement? You've been satisfied?
Yeah, it's very different. It's different. I'm not pinning anything down as yet. It's too early.
Right.
I'm saying I quite like that. That's interesting. I'm not getting too into it yet. I want to sort of sit back in maybe 2 or 3 weeks and listen to everything in more detail and really see how I feel about it. But the standard of stuff that's coming in is good. So it's very promising at this stage.
That's so cool. Very cool. Yeah, and I think you have an email, basically, that people can send their submissions to. Obviously, Pledge Music is the site, pledgemusic.com.
Yes.
But can you share that email?
Yeah, just bear with me. I'll just get it up.
Oh, sorry. It's like submit. I didn't have it off the top of my head. You're going to end up with Godley. You're going to end up with Godley and Trump.
It's something.
You know that, right?
Oh, don't say such things. Don't even think about it.
You might be the only guy that could polish that torch.
Yes, I might do what I want to, is the question. Okay. Muscle Memory Submissions. All one word, musclememorysubmissions@gmail.com.
Awesome. And people can go to Pledge Music and find out the details and pledge to buy the final products and all that kind of stuff too.
Yes, indeed they can. And if they go, I've got another project running on Pledge as well. I did the artwork for this 10cc box set that I mentioned and the forthcoming Godley and Creme box set. So the artwork I did, some of the artwork, anyway, six pieces are being sold as prints.
Wow.
On Pledge as well.
Wow. Is there anything, you know, so...
God, I'm such a polymath.
Well, That's what I was gonna. That's what I was gonna close with. Like creatively, you've dabbled in so much, right? Is there anything that you haven't tried that I mean, you even danced in the wedding, the Wedding Bells video, even or a dancer. Like, is there anything that you haven't attempted?
Anything that I haven't attempted, I haven't gone anywhere near sport, which is probably a good thing.
I mean, from a creative
Yes,
perspective,
I mean,
like.
I haven't directed a movie yet,
Right, right.
so I'd like to do that. So, I can't think of anything specific at the moment. But I have various ideas for other kinds of projects. I have an idea for a clock, for instance. I have an idea for a play. I have an idea for it's what I found over the years is essentially it's I was joking when I said polymath, but it's all the same stuff, really. It's just that it comes out of different places in different forms, but essentially it's all the same stuff. Whether it's musical pictures or a drawing or a book, to me it all feels like the same stuff. But this one comes out of the eyes, this one comes out of the mouth, this one comes out of the ears, this one comes out of the hands, but it's all whatever I am. And I'm lucky enough to be able to express myself in lots of different ways.
Wonderful. Well, sir, I thank you so much for taking the time to have this conversation, and certainly thank you. Like, I must say, I was a 12-year-old boy when Girls on Film came out, so thank you for showing me sort of new worlds and opening my eyes through a lot of that work in the 80s. I wasn't aware of 10cc at the time, sort of missed that boat as a kid, but I became aware of your work visually in the 80s, through 100 different videos. So I thank you so much for that. And
Well, my absolute pleasure. We enjoyed every minute of providing it.
excellent. And I wish you success on Muscle Memory, and I hope your feature film, materializes this time. It's long overdue.
Thank you very, very much, and good to talk to you.
Likewise. Thank you, sir. And I apologize for Donald Trump. Wherever that goes, it's not going to end well,
The
right?
first apology will suffice. You don't need to apologize twice.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do. Every morning I wake up, it's a
Thank
nightmare.
you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Have a good one.
All right, and you want bye-bye.
I'm a fraud, and all the talking in the world won't change that. Not gonna change the world as a writer. I come here 'cause I like the sound of my own voice, and I get to feel like somebody for a while, and I cheat just like my dad. And if you wanna make good in this world, you gotta punch above your weight, son. And if you get hit and you don't fit, just listen. Polish till it's perfect, 'cause nothing else is. Then upgraded a little, man, how he liked that word. Sure sounded sweeter than lying. The whole polishing thing was a kid's fantasy. He always had some cool looking rides, and I got to drive them on a Sunday. But there one was, he was just cleaning rich folks' cars, and he wasn't quite the down home dream dad we all wanted him to be. He was laying uptown bitches in every motel across the state, and polishing the Edsel, as he called it, was his dirty little secret. In the end, Mom threw him out and wrote a book about it called polish till it's perfect. There's nothing else is. 2 years on, Pop caught something off an heiress. He was banging in Kansas and died on his own in a town called Poverty. Me, I guess it's in the genes. Polish till it's perfect. There's nothing else is. Polish till it's perfect. There's nothing else is. Polish till it's perfect. There's nothing else is. And then upgrade it a little.
Thanks again for listening to this conversation with Kevin Godley. You can find more on his website, which is a really cool site, actually. It's kevin-godley.com, kevin-godley.com. Go check that out and, you know, drop an email to him, that email that he left, and get involved in his Muscle Memory project, because that's pretty badass. You can find more Pods and Sods on our website, which is podsodcast.com. You can also find us on iTunes, on Stitcher, on TuneIn. You can find us on Facebook. If you go to iTunes, feel free to subscribe, say some kind words, click a bunch of stars. All of that is appreciated. You know, we don't run ads, so we like reviews. It kind of feeds our soul. So hopefully you'll get a second to go do that and check us out on Facebook, like I said. So in closing, I just want to say thank you again for listening, and I will close with some words of wisdom that I always close with from Mr. Bill Hicks. Thank you.
The world is like a ride at an amusement park, and when you choose to go on it, you think it's real, because that's how powerful our minds are. And the ride goes up and down and round. It has thrills and chills, and it's very brightly colored, and it's very loud, and it's fun for a while. Some people have been on the ride for a long time, and they begin to question, is this real, or is this just a ride? And other people have remembered, and they come back to us, and they say, hey, don't worry, don't be afraid, ever, because this is just a ride. And we kill those people.
Shut him up. We have a lot invested in this ride. Shut him up. Look at my furrows of worry. Look at my big bank account and my family. This has to be real.
It's just a ride. But we always kill those good guys who try and tell us that. You ever notice that? And let the demons run amok? But it doesn't matter, because it's just a ride. And we can change it anytime we want. It's only a choice. No effort, no work, no job, no savings of money. A choice right now between fear and love. The eyes of fear want you to put bigger locks on your door, buy guns, close yourself off. The eyes of love instead see all of us as one. Here's what we can do to change the world right now to a better ride. Take all that money we spend on weapons and defense each year and instead spend it feeding, clothing, and educating the poor of the world, which it would many times over, not one human being excluded, and we can explore space together, both inner and outer, forever in peace.